Okay, so today is going to be about the International Liberal Order. By this, I mean the set of institutions and security frameworks that have dominated international relations over the last 70 years. These are international institutions that have largely been promoted by the United States, but also Europe. And the question for today is, will this international liberal order survive? We see the rise of China. We see skepticism about globalization from nationalist politicians like Donald Trump, Marine Le Pen, and the next decade will be very important in determining whether we are going to exist in a different international order. So the structure of today's presentation is, well, one is, what is the international liberal order? Secondly, is the international liberal order over? And why might it be over? And what is the future of international governance in the 21st century? That's something that I'll just speak about very briefly. Now, to answer these questions very, very basically, is what is the international liberal order? Basically, it's a US-led order. The US sponsored lots of institutions and security alliances after World War II, and we've lived with this international system for about 70 years. I mean, it's controversial, but it's led to 70 years of largely peace and prosperity. We've had no major wars since World War II. Now, the question is the international liberal order over? And what I always say is possibly. And why might it be over? Well, because of the rise of non-Western powers, but also in particular a reaction against globalization among Western governments. And by Western, I mainly mean like American and European countries. What is the future of global international governance in the 21st century? It's uncertain, but we face many global challenges that require global cooperation, such as the rise of artificial intelligence, internet governance, even things like genetic engineering, we may need global rules on. So, what is the international liberal order? Well, the first thing to say about it is that it's existed for about 70 years. It came into existence after World War II. And it's questionable when it's over. I mean, it's possibly over and declining right now. But it's the framework, the security alliances, the global institutions, they still do exist, but they have weak legitimacy and the main sponsor of those institutions, the United States, is not as committed to them anymore. So, as I said, it came into existence during World War II. And these institutions like the World Bank, the United Nations, the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Funds. So remember those institutions we looked at in lecture four when we spoke about global cooperation. These institutions came into existence after World War II. And basically, they are a reaction to the lessons learned from the 1930s and 1940s. So in the 1930s, we had a global economic recession, and part of the problem of this recession was countries responded to the recession by adopting protectionist measures. Basically, they stopped free trade, they imposed tariff barriers, they focused on self-sufficiency, and this exacerbated the economic crisis. So one of the lessons to learn was, well, if there isn't a global economic recession, let's try and maintain global trade. Let's keep it going. Let's not impose protectionist measures. There was also the issue of radical nationalism, and which ultimately led to international conflicts. So one of the other lessons was, well, let's try and prevent extreme nationalism from developing in regions like Europe and Asia. And instead, let's focus on promoting peace, cooperation, diplomacy, instead of international conflict. So the post-World War II framework for international cooperation was designed to not make the same mistakes as the 1930s and 1940s. So avoid global financial insecurity, avoid the growth of nationalist competition and war. So these are the things that have influenced the international liberal order. So the post-war framework, so 1945 to today, is increase opportunities for diplomacy. So have forums like the United Nations, the World Trade Organization, that can arbitrate, mediate, and help countries come together to negotiate challenges and problems that they have with each other. We should also, the objective after World War II was increase economic and security cooperation. So specifically among liberal democratic countries against the communist threat. So have organizations like the World Bank, what would eventually become the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Funds, what would eventually become the single European markets. All of these things integrate the economies to improve prosperity among these countries. So, and a good example of this is Article 1 of the UN Charter, which outlines the basic objectives of the UN. So it's to maintain international peace and security. So instead of instead of countries fighting against each other, you have these forums where the countries can actually negotiate around the table at the UN Security Council. So you create opportunities for countries to engage in diplomacy rather than war. To develop friendly nations among nations, so have basic equal rights and self-determination. This was really helpful for like countries which were becoming independent and decolonization for post-colonial countries. Also to achieve international cooperation on issues like economic, but also respecting human rights and harmonizing the actions of countries towards common objectives. You know, trying to create international rules, common rules that all countries can agree to. Now, beyond like having international laws, there was also this element of security that, particularly among liberal democratic countries, but also countries that were allied with the United States and against the Soviet Union, there was a common security framework. So in Europe, you had NATO, which was to contain Russia. And then the US provided security to Asian allies such as Japan, South Korea, the Philippines, Australia. And this was a way of containing China. It also extended to the Middle East, where the countries, particularly in the Gulf, that were oil producing, received US security support. So these regions relied on the US providing them with protection, acting as like a global military, a police force that would protect these countries. And ultimately what this did was it maximized these countries' capacity to engage in economic growth. These countries didn't have to worry about their security anymore. France and Germany could trust each other. Like if France was selling metals to Germany, France did not have to worry that Germany would use these metals to build tanks because they were under the same security umbrella. So engage in economic cooperation. So with all this said, the international liberal order it's international. It deals with cross-border issues like trade, migration, conflict, refugees. So not national issues like tax. So a good way of thinking about it is, well, what's the opposite? Well, the opposite is countries are nationalists and like highly sovereign. It's also liberal. It is about promoting liberal values or Western values. So like democracy, the rule of law, multilateralism, which is like global rules, global cooperation. Countries come together, they work together through soft power and diplomacy on issues that cross borders. Free markets and human rights as well. An order is the set of institutions and rules governing relations between countries. It also means the distribution of power among countries. So in this international liberal order, the US dominated. It was a unipolar system where the US provided public goods, like infrastructure for globalization, facilitating economic cooperation, providing security. And the opposite of this is obviously anarchy. So the international liberal order is the United States sponsoring some institutions that promoted liberal values and that dealt with cross-border issues. And returning to a slide that we looked at a few weeks ago, these are just some examples of like liberal institutions that are trying to, you know, solve cross-border problems through the rule of law, through democracy, through protecting human rights, through promoting free trade and capitalism. And as we can see, you know, this, we do live in a highly interconnected world. And these slides are not working very well. But this slide from, you know, last week, that ultimately the US has provided a security and economic framework to facilitate globalization, particularly within Europe and also within Asia, but also within the Middle East as well. So this is a system that we've lived in. Now, the question now is it under threat? Is it ending?